Okay, thank you so much for your attention. Good evening. My name is Nicholas Pauletta. I'm the Director of Public Affairs for the Government of Flanders here in the USA. Our headquarters are where you are tonight, on the 44th floor of the New York Times building. So just so you know where you are this evening. Our general representative here, Tupro, sends his regrets. He was in DC today and he is running late, so he'll definitely be here for the reception. Okay, so I just want to welcome all of you officially. This is all very official with the flags and the banners, so make sure that you have that on photographs and Twitter and Instagram and everything like that, so we get the word out about this amazing project. I want to welcome especially the educators among you, because of course it is an educational curriculum, and maybe a special acknowledgement for Miss Margaret Hoover, the great-granddaughter of President Hoover, of course, and also very involved, as everyone here in the room knows, with the Commission for Relief in Belgium, which is specifically very important to us, to our government, and to the country of Belgium, because, of course, as Sophie de Schaerdrijver very well knows, it saved a lot of Belgian lives, and maybe was very historic in the sense that it was one of the first international humanitarian efforts in the world, or in modern times at least. So it's very special indeed that we have Margaret with us here tonight. So thank you again for coming. So the Government of Flanders is very proud to be hosting the launch of the AFS, the Volunteers curriculum. It's been a great partnership with AFS, and just to be clear, the Government of Flanders didn't dictate anything intellectually or historically. We just supported with funding what governments do best, in my experience at least. So I won't go into detail, leave that to Vincenzo, who will come speak after me. It's just a great endeavor. I've been very proud to be a part of it, as well as our team. And this is it. So it's up front here, a few examples to look into. So I just think it turned out really great, and I hope you think the same. So just marvelous. So I'd like to take this opportunity to thank a few people, of course, and first and foremost AFS, Vincenzo, Nicole, and Melissa, and the whole AFS team has been really great, and for us in the government it's been really a privilege to work with such an American and also international partner, since they have two offices in Belgium, one in the north and one in the south. And of course, it's only the Belgian people that will think that is funny, but that's okay. Then of course, also the development committee, who was the historic backbone of the curriculum, I can say, and in special attention for our speaker tonight, Dr. Sophie de Schaerdrijver, who also participated and was very active in the process. Thirdly, I'd like to acknowledge the National World War I Museum in Kansas City, Missouri, represented here today with Laura Vogt, Director of Education, is that correct?
Yes.
And also, of course, the United States World War I Centennial Commission, represented here by Dr. Libby O'Connell, appointed by President Barack Obama. So thank you so much for joining us today. And just before I turn it over to Vincenzo, I just want to say a few words on why the Government of Flanders is actually sponsoring this curriculum on the volunteers. Some of you might think it's kind of an odd partnership, and I just want to say a few words on that. So a few weeks ago, I was watching the remastered version of a Ken Burns Civil War documentary. So for the Civil War buffs in the room tonight, I know you all know it, and even if you haven't seen the documentary, everyone knows Ken Burns. And in the documentary, there was a professor, Barbara Field, who is a historian in American history here at Columbia University, and I think it was the last episode, and she was saying that, you know, the Civil War really never ended, right? Because what she meant, of course, is the fight for social justice and equal opportunity and civil rights is still going on, which made me think, of course, that maybe the same is true for World War I, right? If we look around the world, especially the last couple of months, the role of women in warfare, the role of women in the military, deployment of women overseas has been very much on the front pages of the newspaper. Also, of course, the whole mental health issues around the men and women returning from overseas deployment, PTSD, which of course 100 years ago was called shell shock, so it's exactly the same problem 100 years ago. And maybe even more dramatic is of course the current conflict in the Middle East, where we see that frontiers and countries and borders were drawn up 100 years ago, and that still has a very, very big impact in the 21st century, just to show you how, you know, the centennial of World War I is not just something of the past, but also very much of the present. And then I just want to end by saying that the government of Flanders is very much committed here in the United States, but also around the world in our partner countries, to commemorate the centennial of World War I. First and foremost by, of course, acknowledging and honoring and remembering the ultimate sacrifice that so many people around the world made in Flanders fields 100 years ago. And like I said before, it's just very much important in all our project and our activities to bring present and past together and kind of really show, you know, people in the 21st century that the centennial of World War I is just not a history project, but a very real project where people can learn from. And that, of course, brings me to my final point, that, you know, education of our future generations, of our youth, not that I consider myself very old, but I still can be educated as well, is just very important. And I really hope that this curriculum really plays a part in that. And I'm sure with all of your help here tonight, it will. So thank you so much. And on that, Vincenzo, please. I'd like to invite you, so for people who don't know Vincenzo, Vincenzo Morlini is the president and CEO of AFS International.
Good evening, everyone. Good evening. Well, first of all, I would like to say really a very deep thank you to Gert and Nicholas for hosting this event here tonight, but in this beautiful place, I'm sure everybody is enjoying this wonderful view. This is not the first time I'm here, but for the ones that are here for the first time, I'm sure you are enjoying this wonderful view. I wish the AFS office we would have the same view. But particularly, I really would like to express a very, very deep thank you for the support that we have received from the Flanders House, from the Flanders government, to this very important project. Volunteers, American Join World War I curriculum. That's a very important project, which we are so happy and so proud to present to the education community today and to our volunteer base around the world. This has been possible thanks to their dedication and thanks to them that they understood the importance of these kind of things. And many of you, most of the people in this room, you all know about AFS, what AFS is all about, how AFS has started. But maybe not all of you know why, what is the liaison, the link between AFS and Flanders, and Belgium and Flanders. By the way, I'm very honored to be host of the State of the Art. And that's a particular privilege to be hosted and supported by the State of the Art. Everything started with a guy that we were, who is pictured in the front cover of this book by the name of Piatt Andrew. You know, he was a director of the Mint here in the US, and in 1914 he decided to run from Massachusetts for the Senate, and he lost the election. And thanks to this great loss of election, many of the people that are here today, in this room today, and 500,000 people who were on the programs during the last 75 years had an opportunity to change their lives. Not to mention the 1,000,000 people and casualties that were assisted and supported by the ambulance drivers during World War I and World War II. So never a loss or an election produced such a great benefit to the society. Piet Andrew, when he lost this election, he decided to do something as an American, as a volunteer, sailing to Europe and volunteering as an ambulance driver in the American hospital in Paris. But in those days, he was just, you know, moving people from the train station to the hospital back and forth, and he soon realized that there was definitely the need for something more, for something much more effective. And so in April of 2015, he started the ambulance service, having agreed with the military of France in those days that the ambulance drivers could serve on the front of the war. And this happened in France, and this happened in Belgium, in Flanders. And so 100 years ago, in 1915, this very special relationship between Flanders, between Belgium Flanders and France was started with the AFS. So the American Field Service started 1 year ago thanks to the courage of these people. It always strikes me how 100 years ago, with the war that broke out in Europe, some young American people decided to cross the ocean, to go against the unknown, and against the odds, you know, to do such a great service. And this is such a story that we believe it needs to be honored. And this is also the reason for this book of today. The origin of volunteerism. The origin of a very special volunteerism here in the US, but not only in the US, because today AFS is an organization that is driven, supported, and run by volunteers. Volunteerism is who we are and what we are. AFS would not be here without volunteers. And many of the people in this room are volunteers, and so you know very well what I am talking about. Well, those guys, those two guys that are pictured in this cover, the other one being Steve Galari, that he took over after the passing of Piet Andrew at the end of World War II, after a gathering with the ambulance drivers who were back from the battlefields, and they decided that they had to do something, they could do something. Probably not everybody knows that there were two groups. You know, I know these things because they are not written in the books, but I remember my very good friend Arthur Howe, who passed away some months ago, was telling these stories. He said there were two groups, the thinkers and the drinkers. In my view, also the thinkers were also drinkers. But at the end, the thinkers, they took over. And they said, we have to do something, and not just meet and enjoy ourselves, having parties or remembering the good old times in Italy or in North Africa or in Burma, in Asia, or in different other places. And so they started this great program, which is the Student Exchange Program, which we are running since nearly 70 plus years now, and which has produced so many benefits to so many people in the world. I am one of those. I left 50 years ago. I came by boat from Italy to the US, and it is thanks to those great people that this has changed, that my life has changed for the better, and that I am here today enjoying this beautiful evening with all of you guys. And I think that many of you in this room now can say thank you. Thank you to those guys that 100 years ago and 70 years ago had these great ideas. So we are still celebrating the centennial of AFS, and we have decided to create this tool, this this curriculum, the volunteers. All the lessons of this free curriculum are aligned with the UNESCO Global Learning and the US Common Core Educational Standards. The lesson plans help the students to analyze the history of World War I through the lens of volunteer service, both before and after the period of American neutrality. The curriculum contextualizes the important humanitarian work of organizations like the American Field Service and the Commission for Relief of Belgium within the broader scope of the US-American volunteerism during the war, emphasizing the significant contributions made by these volunteers and placing them within the broader historical context. Importantly, it also aims to continue the legacy of volunteerism established during World War I and encourages students to engage in local, regional, and international service. The volunteers curriculum was created by AFS Intercultural Programs together with a distinguished development committee of educators, archivists, and historians. The curriculum was generally supported by the general representations, as I said, of the Government of Flanders to the USA, an important sign, really, of the special friendship that the Belgium Flanders and the US, particularly AFS, have had since World War I, and which clearly exists today. Nicholas was mentioning that we have two AFS partners in Belgium. That's the only country. That's the only country where we have two partners.
How much we love
you. Yes, exactly. We have 60 partners in 60 different countries, because in Belgium we have two partners in one country, but in Uruguay and Argentina we have two countries and one partner. So we match it up. We are honored that the curriculum has received official endorsement from the US World War I Centennial Commission. The lesson plans were developed in partnership with the National World War I Museum and Memorial in Kansas City. Hello, Lori, we are so honored to have you here. And the curriculum specialist at the Primary Source. That was an unbelievable work that developed by Primary Source, a nonprofit resource center dedicated to advancing global education. I have many people to say thank you, but I would like to ask Nicole, my staff, who was primarily in charge together with Melissa, but she was very much involved in the implementation and the realization of this project, just to say a few words of thank you to the people that we really want to thank you for this important achievement.
Hi, everybody. So I am extremely pleased that representatives from all of our partners and sponsors are here today. You've heard their names multiple times by this point, but they're that important that we're going to say them again. So this includes Libby O'Connell of the New York City and U.S. World War I Centennial Commissions, and I see other members of the commission here today as well. Laura Vogt, again, from the National World War I Museum and Memorial. She serves as their curator of education and was very key in this project. Additionally, I see Susan Zeiger from Primary Source, who was part of every stage of this project, as well as many distinguished members of our Curriculum Development Committee, including Melissa Lyles in the front row, our Chief Education Officer at AFS. And I know Tanya Miro is somewhere in the back. She's at iEarnUSA now as well. We also have a few key AFSers here. We have some wonderful staff from both our international and American offices. And we also have Corinna Fisk and her husband here. Corinna is the great niece of A. Pyatt Andrew, the founder of the organization, and we are incredibly pleased to have her here today. Additionally, we have a descendant of Richard Hall and Louis Hall, who were brothers who served in World War I with AFS, and we have a descendant from that family here today as well. As well as many other AFS alumni and friends, and I see many friendly faces here, and we're so happy to have you. But really, just in general, I really want to thank all of you for being here today. Thank you for joining us in celebrating the release of this very unique curriculum, the curriculum that honors the past in many ways, but importantly speaks to the future by highlighting how volunteerism is a key component of intercultural competence and global citizenship education today. Your support of this project will move it forward into classrooms and across borders. I encourage you to look at the curriculum tonight. We have some samples up here. Feel free to browse. We also have a new website that launched today, and the address is in your brochures that you have. But I also would encourage you to meet each other today. We have some very distinguished people here and incredibly intelligent and wonderful people. And I want you to meet each other and talk about these volunteer efforts of World War I and the impact of those efforts today, and also brainstorm about how we can create a better world together. So thank you.
Thank you so much, Nicole, and thank you again to everyone here. Now I would like to introduce our next distinguished speaker. Margaret Hoover is an author and the great granddaughter of a former U.S. President Herbert Hoover, who coordinated the Commission for Relief in Belgium during World War I. Ms. Hoover will say a few words, I believe, about the humanitarian efforts of her great-grandfather and what it means to her today. I have to say very honestly that I was expecting a 78-year-old lady be the great-granddaughter of Herbert Hoover. We have a very fine young lady. Thank you. You are very welcome.
For the lovely introduction. Thank you, Nicole, for your incredible work on this project, which is, my goodness, I think of myself as a young woman. I learned from history in eighth grade, American history, that Herbert Hoover's contribution to humanity had been actually causing the Great Depression in the United States. And I wish that my teachers had had this volunteer curriculum, because what I learned much later and also from my family, but then also on my own, and it, as any rigorous person on their own can learn American history on their own terms, not just from the sources in your textbooks, that there's a much more nuanced and important story and contribution that Herbert Hoover was part of. Thank you, Gert, and thank you, Nicholas. This is my first time in the Flanders House, and I'm delighted to finally be here. I've heard so much about it. I've seen Gert in several places around town. And, you know, the importance of volunteerism, I think, can't be overstated. As I think about the millennial generation, which is the subject of the book that I wrote about, who the millennial generation are and what makes them tick, they're essentially globally oriented. And they're a generation that is more volunteer oriented than any generation before them. And there is an extraordinary story embedded in World War I that risks being completely lost on generations if it weren't for efforts like this, to tell the story of how UNICEF and how international humanitarian food relief organizations that we just take for granted today, right? We know that when there's a crisis in Somalia or a crisis somewhere in the world, there are going to be international actors that come together in order to deliver food relief and medical relief and all sorts of relief to populations that are in need. And we don't know how that came about necessarily. And that the seeds of the first large-scale humanitarian relief were in World War I, were with the Commission for the Relief of Belgium, and were implemented entirely by volunteers. First starting with Herbert Hoover, who decided on his own that he would undertake the task only on the condition that he were a volunteer. And he knew that he couldn't do it if he weren't a volunteer, that he wouldn't be able to get everybody else working together also with volunteers. I always read this quote because it blows my mind. Upon thinking about the task ahead of him, Hoover wrote that he was greatly troubled over many parts of the problem of feeding the Belgian population. He was not bothered himself personally over administrative matters such as the purchase and overseas shipment of international transport of large quantities of materials. Any engineer could do that. But there were other phases for which there were no former human experience to turn to for guidance. It would require that we would find the major food supply for an entire nation, raise the money to pay for it, get it past navies at sea and occupying armies at land, set up an agency for distribution of supplies for everybody justly, and to see that the enemy took none of it. This was not relief in any known sense. This was the feeding of a nation. And the feeding of a nation, which ultimately sustained a third of Europe's population during World War I, was implemented entirely by volunteers. The millennial generation doesn't know this. Much of America doesn't know this story. And this is why I salute you, Nicole, and I salute AFS and Vicento and all of your efforts to revive this story and make it real again for a generation that has so much to be proud of in terms of our voluntary efforts and how philanthropy can be turned outward to the world. So I appreciate you being here. Thank you for your efforts, and thank you very much for inviting me to say a few words.
Go anywhere else tonight.
Oh,
I couldn't find a smaller book. So.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Okay. And now it's my real honor and privilege to introduce the star of this evening, fellow Belgian and also fellow historian, although I'm a little bit less academic eminent as my fellow historian, Professor Dr. Sophie de Schaapdrijver. Teaches modern European history at the Pennsylvania State University. She is a social and cultural historian of the First World War with specific focus on military occupations. Among her books are De Grote Oorlog, Het Koninkrijk België tijdens de Eerste Wereldoorlog, which means the Great War, the Kingdom of Belgium, in the First World War, which is really the classic book on Belgium during the First World War. So it really is a great privilege for everyone here tonight. It's a real treat, please believe me, but you'll hear from herself a little bit later. And her latest book, Gabrielle Petit, Death and Life of a Female Spy of the Great War, just published last year, I believe. She edited Military Occupation in the First World War, a theme issue of First World War Studies. She has held scholarships and visiting appointments from the National Humanities Center, the Netherlands Institute for Advanced Studies, the École des Hautes Études en Sciences Sociales, and the Institute of the Arts and Humanities at Penn State. It's only one page. She's also active as a public historian. In 2014, she co-wrote and presented the four-part historical documentary Brave Little Belgium, which I recommend that everyone watches. It was on the Flemish Public Broadcasting Company in the previous years. She curated the historical exhibition Bruges at War 1418 and the historical exhibition Between Community and Violence, Alst in the Great War. Furthermore, she participated in the BBC Radio 4 documentary The Great War of Words and has written for The Guardian Online. Her work was awarded for the Free Speech Prize, in Dutch that sounds the Arkprijs van het Vrije Woord, in 1999. In 2013, she received the Gold Medal of the Flemish Parliament. And in 2014, the King of Belgium named her commander of the order, in the Order of the Crown, rather. She received the annual Public History Prize of Davidsfonds last year. And finally, she participates in the Oxford University Network, Hunger Draws the Map, Blockade and Food Shortages in Europe, 1914-1922. So very fitting that you're here as well, which was awarded the Leverhulme International Networks Grant in November 2015. So please join me in welcoming Professor Sophie de Schaapdrijver.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Nicolas. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you, Nicole. Thank you, Vincenzo. Thank you, everybody, for being here. It's an enormous honor to be here at the launch of a curriculum that celebrates volunteering in the First World War, that celebrates that great collective effort that is the American Field Service. Now, the First World War was really, let's see if I can, whoops, okay. All right, let me, yes, there we go, wonderful. The First World War was a golden age of volunteering, and we have a paradox right there. Because the First World War was also a time of intense, never before seen regimentation. If you lived in the First World War, your life was going to be impacted by official decisions. There was the draft, of course, but there were also other decisions on mobility, about mobility, communication, correspondence, unions, businesses, you name it. At the same time, if you were living in the First World War, and especially if you were a member of the educated middle class, you would be very likely to volunteer, to have fun drives, to collect goods, to map out needs, to knit socks for the boys. Or some of you may even drive an ambulance or dress wounds. And you would do this regardless of what side you were on. There were volunteers in Germany. There were volunteers in Russia. In fact, in Russia, civil society is taking over a lot of the tasks that the inefficient Tsarist state is incapable of doing. There were volunteers in neutral societies, the Netherlands, Argentina even, and of course in the United States. The American volunteers who traveled to Europe considered the war a test of character, in the words of the poet Alan Seeger, who wrote, "It's always been my purpose so far as possible to seek the intensest forms of emotional experience." Or the avant-garde writer Gertrude Stein, who already lived in France and volunteered to drive a supply truck. And she wrote, writing about herself, "The landscape, the strange life stimulated her." Before I go deeper into what makes US volunteering, let me say something about volunteering in the First World War generally. You can link this wave of volunteering to yet another deep paradox about the war, and that is this. This is a war that brings unprecedented harm to human bodies, precisely at a time when knowledge about the human body, its needs, is at a peak. Let me engage in some Q&A. Who of you is familiar with Pilates? Exactly, it's on our to-do list. Precisely, well, did you know that Pilates originated in the First World War? Joseph Pilates was a German boxer on tour in England when the war broke out, and he was interned as an enemy alien, where he was then allowed to develop exercises for convalescing soldiers. And he would, of course, be using whatever was at hand as resistance material, bed springs, you name it. And that's how he came up with the Pilates method. And I refer to this little story because it never ceases to boggle my mind that this great advance, this improvement in the knowledge of the human body, which for us today, or for many of us at least, is or should be part of our routine, was generated exactly at a time when millions of bodies were mangled beyond recognition. We know that 9 million men died in the First World War, but many more were permanently damaged, possibly 20 million possibly more, cripples, blinded men, burnt men, amputees, paraplegics. And that is not what the 20th century had been about. That is not what people in 1900 thought the future would bring. Let me give you an example, industrial accidents. In 1900, industrial accidents are no longer seen as the necessary byproduct or the regrettable byproduct of progress. No, there is legislation. Employers have to enact safety measures. It's modest by our standards, but by the standards of the time, it's a breakthrough. And yet, what is the First World War but a gigantic industrial accident in which millions of perfectly healthy young bodies are thrown in the path of destructive machinery, in which red-hot shards of shells propelled by high-impact explosive fly through the air, ripping through brains, and that precisely at a time when neuroscience has its first triumphs, 1906, Nobel Prize. I could go on, but you get the point. And then there was the damage to civilians' bodies, which also clashed with what was known and what was expected. Two major strategies of the First World War, the British blockade and German submarine warfare, were designed precisely to withhold calories from enemy civilian populations, precisely at the time when the calorie becomes a household term. And there were other food crises. There was a man-made refugee crisis, which also led to food shortage. And this at a time when knowledge about nutritional deficiency diseases is at an all-time high. This at a time when the word calorie comes into use, 1912. The word vitamin comes into use, 1912. And here we are, the withholding of vitamins as a weapon of war. So in short, what we're looking at is a time period of great expectations about healthy bodies, thriving bodies, fulfilled bodies, clashing with great exactions. And it is into this gap that volunteering flows. Volunteering massively acknowledges the fact that wherever the fronts are, the Somme, the Alps, Gallipoli, Mesopotamia, the ultimate front of the war is the human body, that of soldiers and that of civilians. And it is in that context that we should look at American volunteering in the First World War. Now, that context of care for bodies does not catch all of American volunteering in the war. There is, of course, also armed volunteering, and I just want to highlight the example of this extraordinary gentleman, the young African-American Eugene James Bullard, who left Jim Crow South in 1913 for Europe and took service, volunteered with the French Foreign Legion, and became the first black military aviator in world history, but sadly was not allowed to join the US Flying Corps. Bullard would be a volunteer twice over during the Second World War. He entered the French Resistance. But to return to unarmed volunteering, it is striking that the two major collective American volunteer efforts precisely hinge around the care for bodies, the American Field Service, the bodies of wounded soldiers, and the Commission for Relief in Belgium for the bodies of trapped civilians. So let's start with the Field Service, which was founded in April 1915, a small corps of young men who volunteered to drive ambulances. We've heard about this. For the most part, Ivy League students or professionals affluent enough to pay their passage, their living expenses, and their equipment. But they did get their hands dirty. They volunteered to drive up to the furthest front lines. Sorry about the quote, it's pretty disturbing. They volunteered to drive up to the fighting line, operated under serious danger, and many would forever remain scarred by what they had seen. And one example is the doomed poet Harry Crosby, truly a member of the lost generation. Whoops. Oh, it's running away from me. Don't do that. No! Okay. Come on. Okay, yes.
I mean, you're putting an archivist on this. I don't know if this is the best idea.
All right, let's see. Well, otherwise, I can just run over and
get some.
Thank you. Yes, thank you very much. So,
not full. Oh, okay, thanks. Another example of someone who saw the destruction and never forgot it was the great American painter Waldo Pierce, AFS volunteer, first in Alsace and then in the Balkans, friend of John Reed and of Herb Hemingway, and who had this striking image of what it is like to ferry wounded bodies from the front to hospitals. He calls those bleeding bodies in the car corpuscles in the full crimson tide, this crimson stream ever rolling from the trenches to the hospitals. And outside of the AFS, outside of the AFS, we have another striking volunteer, Mary Borden, an alumna of Vassar, who used her own funds to create a field hospital close to the front where she worked as a nurse. And she would write these incredible words. Okay, I'm going to not touch. Oh, no, that's
all right, well, anyway, I won't touch it. She would write the incredible words, "There are no men here, there are heads and knees and mangled testicles, but no men." Or to quote her colleague, Ellen Newbold Lamotte, who figures in our curriculum, "Thus the science of healing stood helpless before the science of destroying." And these healing efforts would leave a great many of those volunteers with a sense of ambivalence, because ultimately, in the face of industrial level destruction of human flesh, there was only so much you could do. But there was another type of volunteering that created a more confident sense of achievement. And that is what Margaret Hoover was talking about earlier, the first great sustained humanitarian effort in world history, which started concretely enough with an effort to get bread to Brussels, pistolets, le pain quotidien. The German army occupied most of Belgium. Belgian civilians were therefore trapped. And you really are looking at the most densely populated country in the world. Population the size of Canada, on territory the size of Maryland. So you can quite imagine. So immediately there's a food crisis, which civil society immediately tries to remedy. And one of the most active committees is in Brussels. And they sent somebody over to London to negotiate a shipment of flour. And that man has the brilliant idea of visiting a friend of his who's a mining engineer in London with interests in six continents and a desire to enter public life. And that man is, of course, Herbert Hoover, and the rest, as they say, is history. Hoover takes a great interest in the plight of Belgium, because it's important to realize Belgium was neutral at the time, as neutral as Switzerland is today, and therefore counted as an innocent in this war. And Hoover creates a group of volunteers, Commission for Relief in Belgium, 150 men who are going to oversee the shipment of food to Belgium, make sure that the German army doesn't take it, and so forth. Like the field service, these are young white men of affluent backgrounds coming from top colleges, many of them Rhodes Scholars. One of them calls it an American aristocracy. The same exclusive demographic that populated at the time the Department of State. And this exclusiveness leads to a certain chauvinist outlook. For instance, in this excerpt reproduced in our curriculum, one of the delegates describes the group as intelligent thinkers with a practical turn of mind, accustomed to independence and initiative. They were Anglo-Saxons of the Western world, because obviously this quality only adheres to this demographic. But I will say that for all the occasional chauvinism, now please let the God of clickers be with me. Please. Oh, good. For all this occasional chauvinism, what you see that Commission for Relief doing is extremely instructive for volunteering today. It is able, these people are able extremely well to work with efforts on the ground. Because on the ground, there is another volunteering effort. The Belgian National Committee, which is a much larger organization, 125,000 agents, and you get a wonderful division of labor between the two organizations. Because what the Americans can do, what the Belgians cannot do, is take unpopular decisions. Because the Americans will eventually leave. And therefore, there's a division of labor with the Belgians. As one commission delegate writes, our Belgian co-workers were as eager as we were to have the work done well, but while they were volunteers like ourselves, they were not disinterested aliens, but responsible citizens. They could not make enemies, so we took the initiative. Because sometimes political sensibilities had to be thwarted, sometimes unpopular decisions had to be made, and so the Americans were able to do that. And as this delegate writes, in this, as in other matters, our neutrality was no negative thing, it was positive. And it would leave these delegates with a positive sense of their achievements. The collective work could not prevent that civilians did go hungry, that children went hungry, that you could see after the war that they had been hungry during the war, but they were triumphs. For instance, infant mortality drops compared to the pre-war, so that is really something. Importantly, this work helps establish the idea of national health as a priority for structural effort more than ever before. As did, to give another example, the work of Edith Wharton, the novelist who in Paris works for child refugees, which resonates deeply with her ever since, as a young woman, she published her first poem about the plight of a boy of 12 who in the Philadelphia House of Refuge had been in solitary confinement and had hung himself in his cell, and she had never forgotten it. The despair of abandoned children resonated deeply with her. And so she acted on what she called the necessities of the hour, heeding the verse from Ecclesiastes, whatsoever thy hand findeth to do, do it with thy might. And that brings me to my concluding point. Can we generalize about these volunteer efforts and their impact? Well, we can say two things. First, although they are volunteer efforts, they decisively steer care away from the occasional and the charitable towards the continuous and the structural. Because of these efforts, things like nursing, nutrition, veterans' health, preventing epidemics, and so on, become matters of official concern. And that is because, and that brings me to my second point, the volunteer effort of wartime has decisively extended the circle of empathy, has led people to think, to put themselves in the shoes of victims of war, there but for the grace of God. A children's health crisis in a faraway country, people sheltering in shacks in a bomb-infested former battlefield. And so we see after the war, the American Red Cross enlisted 600 nurses and a great many auxiliary personnel to work in post-World War I Germany, Central Europe, and Russia. And these women are going to run health clinics, make home visits, and so forth. And they do more than that. In a significant way, they play a role in US foreign relations. And then there is the next example. The American Committee for Devastated France, Anne Morgan's wonderful initiative, which helps the people of the horribly torn battlefield remake their lives, and introduces in the process some wonderful novelties, such as my personal favorite, the introduction of the OpenStack library. I will let that sink in. There were libraries, but they were not OpenStack. So now for the first time, French children and grown-ups too, for that matter, would enjoy the sheer pleasure of walking through open stacks and serendipitously getting books from the stacks. I mean, that is just wonderful. And then, well, this is a very sad sight of stunted children. Austria suffered a horrible food crisis during the war, but we do see that Quaker food relief after the war, and of course we should remember that Herbert Hoover was a Quaker, tries to not just remedy this as far as is possible, and to some extent it is not possible, but at least educate people about this. So in short, it is volunteering that takes public action to the next level. It is volunteering that structurally extends the circle of empathy. And it is true that humanitarian volunteering in the war did not answer the thorny question of whether care in war was not a palliative when war itself was the problem. But they did not have time to address these questions because their time horizon was the urgent one of the human body. Some would ask that question, but later. And in the meantime, there was work to be done. Or to quote the great French humanist Albert Camus, even with the greatest possible effort, all one can do is try and lessen the pain in the world a little. So three cheers for volunteers. Thank you.